valuable assets that spend part of their time in one country or in the waters of one country, if we're talking about whales, have an agreement and that they're allowed to go about their natural lives. Look, I'm so sorry to have to wind this up because we could talk for some time, but there's another Zoom room awaiting for us. And I thank you, Eckhart and Ralph, for stimulating, thought-provoking and lively exchange of ideas.
Thank you, Ian. Good to see you. Good to see you, Eckhart. Thank you all.
Thank you and welcome back, or welcome to this new session if you've just joined us, where we discuss protecting wildlife through technology and law enforcement. If you just joined us from a previous session, you'll know we were looking at the value which can be attributed to individual elephants, which if left to go about their business in the forest, far, far exceeds anything you can get from cutting off these front teeth that I've got protruding from my left shoulder of this fine forest elephant. He's alive and well and in the forest still. And if he lives his full life, then the carbon sequestration attributable to him would be $1.75 million or more as the price of carbon goes up. So here's the challenge for our panel now is how do we monitor these elephants? How do we protect them from the misguided people who think that chopping off their front teeth that brings in a few tens of thousands of dollars, if they're lucky, or a few hundred dollars if at the bottom end of the trade chain, is the only way they're going to benefit from this amazing creature behind me. So I'm joined for this discussion with Gautam Shah, who's a founder of the Internet of Elephants. Now there's a tantalizing title. I'll get you to introduce what that is about shortly. Sarah Maston, who's the founder of a Microsoft Project 15, which I learned about recently and is very exciting. So I'm really pleased you've been able to join us. And Dr. Timothy Wittig, who is working with United for Wildlife and is particularly interested in the intelligence in the sense of gathering information to help enforce the law. I hope I've encapsulated very briefly what you're about. Can I follow that same order? Gautam, would you like to introduce your work to the audience? You'll have to unmute yourself.
Myself, there we go.
Yeah.
Yes, hello everybody. Thanks very much, Ian. Yeah, absolutely. I run a company called Internet of Elephants. It's the wildlife conservation space and the space that I'm in is definitely not where I used to be. So I spent 20 years as an IT consultant for Accenture. Before I finally made the decision to quit and kind of pursue a life of passion around wildlife and conservation and figure out, you know, what are the ways that technology can play a role, in doing so. So we are entirely on the public engagement side of things, right? And so I'd always kind of felt like, well, if I could do anything to get the world engaged, I would just pick up 8 billion people and, you know, in order, plop them in the middle of the forest in Borneo. And, you know, and 10 to 15% of them would be changed people. And that would have a massive impact. But short of us being able to do that, how could I do whatever we could to use technology to try and create the same emotions, to create the same connections, to figure out how can an individual in St. Louis be connected with that forest elephant that's that's right behind you, that's thousands of miles away, and you know, in a way, create a relationship with wildlife that just that just doesn't exist today. So that's effectively what Internet of Elephants does. The name Internet of Elephants is this idea that if people can be connected to people, if people can be connected to their refrigerators, their cars, etc., what would happen and how would it change in the world if people could be connected to Moituria the elephant or Fio the orangutan or Ashaya the jaguar? So what we essentially do, and maybe I'll just share something to make it somewhat clearer. Is that coming through?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. So everything that we do is based on real wildlife data and real wildlife science. We're not the scientists, we're not the ones that go out and do the research, but effectively there's unbelievable amounts of science research data being collected everywhere. And that's just a gold mine of information, a gold mine of stories, and a gold mine of opportunities. And so, I use this picture to say, like, we take everything that's typically going into a scientific journal and we start converting it into playable interactions, ways that the overall general public can actually get involved in that science in a way that's very consumable for them, fun for them, and a way for them to connect. And that typically translates into games, data visualizations, and other types of, other types of interactive media. So Wildiverse was a game about being a researcher in Borneo or in Ndoki National Park in the Congo and studying specifically for real individual apes. And all the information and everything that comes through an augmented reality in Wildiverse is about, is about being that researcher. Stories of the Wild are data visualizations based entirely on GPS movements of an elephant, a pair of lions, sisters, and a herd of wildebeest. Unseen Empire documents 10 years worth of camera trap studies in Southeast Asia on the clouded leopard, and actually brings that all to you, and now you have to play the researcher and actually go ahead and ID these photographs, set up the sites, and know what that's really like. But in the process, you get to see spectacular camera trap images along the way. And Hollows and Growlers, it's not out yet, but it's something that we're working on that's all about trying to mimic animal vocalizations in the wild, but again in a social sort of party atmosphere. So this is these are the types of things that we're doing entirely. How do we use tech? How do we use new mediums? How do we use new platforms to try and create massive public engagement with wildlife and its conservation? I will stop there.
Thank you. So clearly technology is coming into it, and I don't know if anyone else is going to talk about VR, but that offers people the chance to literally be immersed in an ecosystem. If you've got your headphones on and your peripheral vision is filled with a 360 image. So there's a website called Vecotourism, V for virtual, ecotourism.org, where we've been experimenting with that. Sarah, tell us a little bit about Project 15, which comes from within the Microsoft Corporation, as I understand it. We're all used to dealing with Microsoft products, but how's Microsoft helping elephants and other species?
Hi. I'm so happy to be here, and that's a good question. I'm following the coolest game that I just am learning about the other day. I'm like, whoa. So yes, I'm Sarah. I'm a solution architect at Microsoft. I focus generally on what Gautam just said about connecting to your refrigerator or having an experience with your car or these smart systems. My day job is to create those systems and work with the data and making things happen up on the Microsoft Azure cloud. However, one day I found a way to apply one of the systems I had made into conservation, and that led to what we're talking about here today, Project 15. And so I have some slides to share to bring you sort of through a bit of an origin story journey, and also can help to explain a little bit what it means when I say IoT solution architect, you may not be familiar with the term IoT. It stands for Internet of Things and those connected things, devices sending information. So let me just share with you, if I can get this to work. All right, so Project 15 from Microsoft really was an aha moment. I invite you to go out. We have a little video that explains a little bit of the origin story that I'm going to cover here. And before I get into what it is, I will tell you a true fact is that this all starts with my cat. She looks very angry. And the reason she looks angry is because there was a fire in my apartment building. And I ran into this building to save her. So I saw a lot of smoke. I lived in this building complex. I saw a lot of smoke. I panicked and there was no bell yet. And I ran in and I saved my cat and I ran back out. And the next day I went to the office. I said, what was that? That was really scary. And they said, oh, I don't know why you were upset. That fire was really far away from you. And I went, what? And then it turned out that the smoke had been blown across the garage floor that connects all the buildings. And that's what I saw. So they told me the fire had been out for 20 minutes. And I pretty much jumped up and down and, you know, was, you know, got upset. And I said, there has to be a way to communicate better in an emergency to people within the emergency. And that led to a project called Project Edison. And how it worked in a proof of concept way is that if you think about a smart bulb and, you know, a map, and here's this pin on the map, and here's Joanne. And Joanne is in a meeting room with a light bulb, and the system knows where the light bulb is. So if something happened where Joanne is on a campus, she could be within a radius of awareness to an event. And now her light bulb has turned yellow. And that means don't panic. Don't stress. Something has happened, but it's not near you. Please go make decisions and get more information. If it happens closer to her, then it turns red and she can do her safety drill. So it may occur to you that this is a safety platform, and it is, and it was for safe schools and workplaces. And we put it out on open source, and our partner ecosystem, some people built solutions on that idea, and there's actually a safe school system running in Houston, Texas, based on that idea right now. And then I met Dr. Eric Dinnerstein, who has a solution called TrailGuard, and many of you may be familiar with Eric and his work. And I learned that he had a camera trap that could detect poachers. And when it did, it would send an alert up to a system, which would then tell the rangers to go, you know, help the animals. And in my head, I thought, oh my God, this is the same use case as a safe school or a safe retail or safe factory. So I started to apply it to, you know, those use cases. And really, what's the difference between loss prevention of a shirt or a sweater in a store and loss prevention of a pangolin in a park? And so really, there might be a way for the commercial solutioning community of technologists to come in and help the scientific projects to accelerate them. And one of the things that we've done and released recently is called the Open Platform for Conservation and Ecological Sustainability. And this is an 80% solution that we put out on GitHub. So it's free. You can download it and then you build upon it. And then you pay for your cloud consumption, of course. But the base solution is free. It's made by myself and my colleague, Daisuke Nakahara. And think of it as a typewriter. So if you're going to write a book, 80% of that solution of writing a book is the typewriter, the word processor, and 20% is your story, and that's your use case. So we really just made a fancy typewriter for sustainability solutions. And I'm just going to end with, you know, we did it to accelerate, we did it to lower the cost of development. Microsoft's mission is to empower every person and organization on the planet to achieve more. And so this is how my little team of friends within Microsoft wanted to empower these solutions and help. And we are now partnered with the Small Grants Program, GEF Small Grants Program, implemented by the United Nations Development Program, to be able to help and scale out some of their grantee projects. So it's pretty exciting.
Well, thank you. That is pretty exciting.
Yes. So anyway.
Okay, here we are. So new technology, new ideas, new connections, all of which must be music to the ears of you, Tim, in that you're trying to help solve the challenge, come up with a solution to the challenge of wildlife trafficking, which is people who, for, I guess, in their minds, perfectly valid reasons, are taking a different course of action, which involves killing animals, trafficking them around the world, and risking arrest and imprisonment, and even being shot by law enforcement officials. How do we apply these new technologies to combat organized criminal gangs with that different agenda?
Okay, great. Thank you, Ian, and thanks, Sarah and Gautam, for really interesting projects, and great to learn about them. So let me talk about what we're doing with Focus Conservation, also United for Wildlife. I'm a head of intelligence for both initiatives, actually. I work for Focus Conservation and implement the United for Wildlife task force, private sector task force intelligence sharing system, which I'll talk about. And just my background, I've worked in the intelligence community. I was an analyst, also been in academia, and also worked with many tech partners and data scientists, including Johns Hopkins University and things. So I think it's been really interesting. And I'll talk about, I think, probably the human dimension of technology, which I think is really important about kind of making this into practice. So here's kind of the problem statement I see for wildlife trafficking. So wildlife trafficking being, if you include timber, probably $100 to $150 billion a year illicit industry, third or fourth biggest illicit trade in the world at the time right now. So the problem statement, kind of the solution, is that we have to work together across sectors. So across private sector, NGOs, conservation groups, law enforcement, government. And we really can't be successful unless we do that. And so I think that's kind of a really maybe unique, but a critical thing about wildlife trafficking. So this causes a lot of complications, though, is because law enforcement and government, they have the authorities to take down wildlife trafficking networks, but often they lack the information to do so, or even the mandate, or sometimes the interest. NGOs are very passionate about doing something about this issue, but they're NGOs, they're non-governmental, so they don't have the NGOs are not supposed to be collecting intelligence, or obviously they don't arrest people or things. And also the private sector, they're really a critical component too, because pretty much all illegal wildlife moves commercially, right? So it all goes on ships or airplanes. And it's all about money, obviously. So it's all the proceeds of that crime, goes into the financial system in one way or the other at some point. So those are really key bottlenecks around that. So this was the genesis. Actually, we're on March 15th will be the 5-year anniversary of this initiative. So Prince William, Duke of Cambridge, and William Hague, former Foreign Secretary of the UK, so they came together and convened what's called United for Wildlife. Task forces, private sector task forces, and it says to create a framework to assist the private sector in combating the illegal wildlife trade. Okay, so a big, I'd say the major operational component of this. So there's commitments that are signed by the companies, but the major operational component of this is the intelligence sharing system, and that's what I've been running since the beginning, and now we're running through Focus Conservation. And I think it's a really interesting thing, and it has a lot to do with technology too. So here's a listing of our members, current members from the banking world, financial task force members. So it's about 45 banks now, and about 130, over 130 transport companies, so airlines, shipping, airports, things like that. And so again, these companies sign these agreements, and then one of the big agreements is that they act on intelligence that's shared with them. And also something that's evolved is that there's now, we act as kind of an honest broker conduit between law enforcement, private sector, and NGOs. So here's a kind of the obligatory diagram for how this works. So we have member companies, We have enforcement partners. We have kind of the, you know, broader ecosystem of policy and conservation groups. I think the key thing is that trusted neural network. So it's this human, it's this really human network of people that makes all of this possible. So from a technological standpoint, tech is a big part of this. And so I think, you know, one of the messages I want to show is that how humans and human networks and technology and technical networks work together is really, I think, you know, is really kind of the answer to the question. And so here are the kind of the critical elements that I see is that information is meant to be shared, right? It's not, information doesn't do anyone any good if it's hoarded. And this is I think this is kind of a perennial problem in the conservation sector, is that information is often seen as almost a commodity to raise funds off of, rather than a lifeblood that, you know, to really share. And then there's also kind of a lot of real world limitations about, you know, you have amazing databases and amazing technical capabilities from a lot of our partners. Microsoft is actually one of our partners. But that, you know, the issues of firewalls and proprietary information, customer information, privacy, GDPR even, you know, these things are, you know, they're really real world constraints. And so I think the answer to this actually is this human network, this neural network, right? And also setting up mechanisms that work within existing authorities, existing laws, but that are very effective about sharing information. So this is what we've been focused on for the last 5 years, and I think we've been pretty successful at. So the way this is done is that, you know, it's a lot of human interaction, a lot of building up trusted networks, and then kind of bringing in technology to fill specific gaps, especially as you're trying to scale things. You know, because we can be very effective on an ad hoc level, just kind of, you know, even using basic technologies. But then if you can scale this, I mean, in order to scale this so that we can have strategic impact on wildlife trafficking, then we really do need technology. So here's actually an example, the thing at the top with the rhino horns. That's from a Microsoft and Heathrow Airport and United for Wildlife program called Project Seeker. It's about using AI to automatically detect illegal wildlife in during the baggage screening process, you know, for airports. IATA, the industry association, is supportive of this, and they actually have a parallel project that's similar, and it's being scaled out in Africa and Asia too. And so I think that's been a great initiative, and it's also an example of kind of the stuff that we're doing that we can use technology to scale these out. There's a great quote about artificial intelligence AI that I think is good to remember, is that AI is anything cool computers can do, which is hard to explain to lay people. I think that's a great kind of definition of AI, because a lot of stuff that was called AI 10 years ago is now just called statistics or other things. So I think AI is kind of an umbrella term for advanced data-driven scalable, you know, solutions. So just an example of what this can lead to, the positive things. You know, 5-10 years ago, you know, in most cases when wildlife was seized, you know, you have big wild, illegal wildlife seizures, you know, multiple tons of ivory or pangolin or whatever, often that used to be the end of the story. And so through our mechanism, through our human network and also the tech network of the intelligence sharing, this is a great example. This is the biggest seizure, I think, in Uganda's history. And so we were, through our relationships with the shipping companies that were actually shipping, the processing the shipment, as well as banks, as well as law enforcement, and as well as NGOs, we were able to take this shipment, and then within 24, 72 hours even, we were able to identify other shipments, 31 other containers that were connected to the shipment or to the suspects. And then we were also able to catalyze, you know, searches and interdictions of those shipments. So it's a great example about how this kind of the proper connection between the human element and the tech element and the information sharing element can really make a difference. And I think overall, I think this may be something we're hearing from a lot of people, is that I think what's happening is that there's a redefining of who is a conservationist now. So I think, you know, kind of the vision often that we have is that a conservationist is someone, you know, in the field, maybe in Africa specifically, working, they're a biologist or a scientist, and that's obviously a critical component of conservation. But I think what we're seeing is that whether you're a tech person or a bank person or a transport shipping company or whatever, law enforcement, DEA agent, focused conservation is founded by a few ex-DEA agents that are working 100% on wildlife now. So what we're seeing is that all these people that are kind of non-traditional, people that you wouldn't kind of put the conservationist label on, actually are having amazing conservation impact. So I think this is a broader point that, we're really in the process of redefining who is a conservationist, and that actually a lot of people and a lot of technologies that maybe even aren't designed for this purpose can actually have really great impact, for saving wildlife. So thank you. Stop there.
Thank you, Tim. That's very, very focused, as one would expect. And that last point is so true. I remember when I was a young biologist in Kenya, one of the old guard conservationists, who of course was ex-military, was chuntering about too many ruddy zoologists in conservation. And now when I hear people asking me about how to get a career in conservation, I'm more likely to say, well, couldn't you just include conservation in your career? And clearly, all three of our panelists today have come to this from a different career. And really, conservation has got to get out of the public has got to see it as something that applies to all of us. We all have to play a role in conservation if this is going to work, this attempt to redefine our relationship with nature. So the comments I've been seeing coming in have all been very excited about the application of technology. And it is true, but even with the best will in the world, technology can go wrong. We've had one or two of the speakers here suddenly freeze up. So how reliable is the technology? And particularly if you're in a delicate operation, as in intelligence-led attempt to arrest someone and the power goes down, the sensors go off. That must, I don't know if you've had that problem, but almost everyone listening on this call from wherever they are in the world will know what I'm talking about. For us, it's a mild inconvenience. That could be a matter of life and death. But Tim, you're muted, so you have to, if you're going to tell us a story.
I was just agreeing with you.
Okay.
I was going to say, this is where, as the worlds are combining, the tech has caught up, I think, with being able to do such amazing things and what we call as the intelligent edge. So when you're putting, intelligence into a camera that can see this is a poacher, this is an elephant, the difference, that's that machine learning, that AI Timothy was talking about. When those things go offline, the commercial space has come up with, many ways to deal with that. Because think about a smart car. You can't have that go offline while you're driving. And if there's a little micro computer in there that's like, hey, do I need to deploy an airbag? You need that to be going all the time. There is no failure. And so I just want to it's kind of a general comment that, those technologies are advancing to bring in those stop gaps, especially in the sensor device world. And that keeps getting better and better as the technology increases.
Fingers are firmly crossed on that one.
And I think maybe some principles that, they hold true for technology, for everything. And it's any kind of technology, not just digital or information technology. But garbage in, garbage out, I think is a good, it's a core principle. If you have, if you have good information and good relationships, then the outputs are going to be much higher quality. The best technology is the one that people use. I think that's another guiding principle. So you can have really good technology, but if for whatever reason, even just bandwidth, internet bandwidth is an issue in Africa, a lot of our law enforcement partners there, they just don't have reliable internet. So having a bandwidth hungry technology is, it's not necessarily useful for them. So I think, it's like kind of the core principles that apply to all technologies. We have to abide by those too in conservation.
But airports, let me just challenge you on that, because airports and seaports are both normally well equipped with technology. You know, planes and ships come in and out, and most countries now have computerized trade records. Mm. I recall seeing a presentation, I can't remember the name of the chap, who was pointing out that every suitcase going onto a plane is x-rayed, but the people are just looking for bombs. They don't want the plane to explode. But if they were told to look for suspicious items, and we know that a huge amount of bushmeat comes into Europe in personal baggage, if people were just told, never mind, you know, yes, look out for bombs, but look out for skeletal patterns too, or as you, your thing showed, rhino horns, although if it's cut up in little segments, it's more difficult to identify. But the existing technology isn't being used to best effect. And another example of that is a friend of mine called Mark Laxer has a company, Data Mining International, and they have software that goes through trade records and looks for anomalies, which are often associated with crime. And so you could decide which of the thousands of containers going through a port you want to look at, because it's not the same weight as every other container that went through, supposedly containing the same stuff. And we've tried to give that away to developing countries so that they can do exactly that, focus their customs officers on the likely illegal shipments. And it's like, I don't know, pushing water uphill. Which led someone to suggest, one of your founders, that perhaps those in a position of authority don't actually want that much technology that might expose things that they or their friends or families might be involved in. I'm just throwing that out as one of the challenges we face.
Definitely. And also there's always an arms race too with technology, where criminals adapt, to new tech too, right? So like, there's a lot of corruption in ports, but so a new kind of insider threat issue in corruption is that is people bribing people for their passwords so that they can actually go into the databases themselves and issue legitimate shipping documents that are fraudulent or bypassing scanning procedures or things like that, so on the platform, everything looks legitimate, but there's actually been some human.
Yes, well, we've been using that phrase in developing rebalance.earth, that we don't need a foolproof system, we need a conniving bastard proof system, because there's someone out there looking for the chink in the armor, and bribing people for passwords is a very good example of that. But more and more people are potentially involved in this. Is there a way, Gautam, that we can sort of gamify this and bring the wider public in? Because people play games which challenge them in a virtual world. I kind of want people to take the VR off and go outside and enjoy the real world. But while they're in there playing, can you use your ingenuity when you've unmuted yourself to tell us whether there's a chance of, we hear a lot about citizen science involving the public in science, and there's huge amounts of data, but there's huge numbers of people sitting at home in the bedroom who could potentially be using their computer, their brain, through their laptop or device to help. How can we gamify and help Tim with his work in intelligence gathering or monitoring shipments of containers or something?
Yeah, well, that's a fantastic question, and it gets a lot into the benefits and possibilities of citizen science, which I think is which has incredible potential. Just kind of speaking from an area of expertise, none of what we do is on the citizen science side of stuff. What we do is we take the science and try and engage people with stuff that's already been determined. But I look at the engagement side and what games can do on the engagement side to really activate people in terms of how does people's behavior impact markets? How does people's behavior and the will of citizens impact policy? How does the will of citizens impact the amount of available financing that can go into the projects that support the interventions on the ground? If the general public is not engaged with it, doesn't feel activated by it, doesn't feel efficacy around anything that they do, and is generally bombarded with doom and gloom campaigns, or you know, things that make, you know, make them very, very passive. I think we've just got a long road in front of us in terms of anything actually, you know, anything actually changing. So the way that we really look at games is, okay, there's a number of people that are happy to watch a nature documentary, but how many people would actually be, you know, potentially more interested in engaging through a game, which, you know, brings across the same information as a nature documentary does, but now makes them feel part of the solution, makes them feel like they can think about ideas, makes them feel like something that they're doing is helping an orangutan in Borneo, or something that they're doing is, you know, is helping a sea turtle swimming, you know, swimming through the Red Sea. So that's the, you know, that's where we see the power of games, is really this feeling of I'm part of this. It's not just these people telling me a story and telling me what to think and telling me that conservation is important and telling me that an orangutan needs to be saved and telling me that palm oil is bad, but it's giving me the opportunity to actually play a part of that story, to, you know, to feel like I have, you know, that I have a role in it. And that's what we think has the downstream impact, or the upstream, I don't know what's the right word, upstream or downstream impact on the, you know, the products that are sold in the market, what people are buying, how people are behaving, the amount of finance. You know, I think we all know that the amount of philanthropic dollars that actually go to nature and wildlife is just tiny, right? Now, you know, how does this start to shift this? And how does this start to actually start getting in front of politicians and saying like, hey, wait a second, everybody is interested all of a sudden in wildlife. Everybody's playing these wildlife games in the same way that everybody was watching Game of Thrones, etc. How does that change the way that I might think about policies in my country? Because my people are now telling me that they're interested, you know, via these different platforms.
It sounds like the modern version, when radio soap operas were first invented as a drama series, the idea was to educate people about farming methods with the archers in England. It's still running as a radio series on the BBC, but games are a new way of perhaps bringing that information into the, especially the younger generation. That's what, just had a comment here from Kate Gilman-Williams. Don't forget, our younger generation can save wildlife and wild spaces. In fact, we must, by the time I turn 25 years old, all elephants might be gone, she writes. Teaching technology to kids is key. And I agree with her in terms of gaining their attention, because the younger generation seem, you know, they don't watch telly across the living room anymore. They watch stuff in the palm of the hand. But it's the connecting that to the real world. It seems so distant. And that exactly. I don't know exactly to what extent your games do explain that. I don't know if some of the purchase price goes to help the animals, but I just a heads up, next month, all being well, we'll be launching a new streaming channel called EcoFlix, where your subscription actually goes to pay for conservation.
Yeah.
So the only shareholders are the animals, which is, and I'd love to talk to you separately offline about getting your games onto there, because games and viewing videos and consuming content is what everyone seems to want to do now, to reach out to people. But if we can get a significant stream of the revenue into the people who are either living alongside or protecting those animals, that's what we need to do. A comment from Chip Commons, can Sarah and Microsoft and Dr. Wittig et al. Apply this amazing thinking and innovation to create a technology stroke app tracking deforestation and ultimately the burning and forcing of man-made CO2 and other greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, now collapsing the global biosphere? So it's all on you guys, create the technology to not just monitor, but then enable the response to prevent the negative things that are happening.
No pressure. So yes, okay. So, you know, when you, I do a lot of speaking around Microsoft's stance on sustainability, you know, bigger than Project 15, the stuff I'm doing. And we're really focused, I know we don't have a lot of time today, but the four main categories that at least Microsoft has gone really big on, especially this year with some big announcements, is carbon and energy, water, waste, and then ecosystems. And agriculture and land falls under ecosystems. And that's kind of the corner where Project 15 is sitting, along with such amazing groups in Microsoft called, you know, AI for Earth, AI for Good. So when you think about IoT and these devices, like, the devices are going to drive sustainability because they're going to get all those measurements to do what, you know, what you're talking about. Can we get it so that we have the solutions so then we can take action and do something? And then it reduces it and you get that feedback loop. Just like if I go into a store and I have, you know, something that knows I got there and it sends me a notification, that's a feedback loop. And so I think, I mean, the answer to that question is broadly yes. And so that's, I mean, that's what I spend my days and nights focused on. And I just wanted to, you know, put in a comment to about the game. I have actually, now that I've been on this learning journey for a little over a year, that's so important to get people to think differently about their local animals. Like, you know, the work you're doing, if you can get, especially the children, there might be some old wives' tales, as they're called, around, you know, those animals come into my town and they wreak havoc, so we have to get rid of them or something. And it's false. Like, those animals are just hanging out and they just walked through or something. And so I think it's just so important, the work, you know, that Gautam's doing in terms of that evangelism for mindset change, which then speaks to what Timothy is saying around, you know, communities who are allowing it to happen. So I just wanted to say that, like, it's, in my mind at least, it's just so connected that if we can all become, like you said, Ian, conservation comes into our jobs from wherever we sit, that that is how we are going to fix these huge problems in general.
Could be a great out, but we've still got 10 minutes, so do come in, Tim.
Yeah, the one thing I was going to add is, you know, I think a lot of the real promise of technology is on these data driven, you know, solutions. But I think one of the kind of dirty secrets of conservation is that the data ecosystem is really pretty poor, right? And so we need better data sets. Yeah, so I think this is, to put it simply, so it's a huge problem actually. So like CITES, you know, for example, CITES has a lot of data about kind of traded species and things, but it's not a very well structured data set. They don't even record seizures in the same way. Some is by volume, some is by weight, some is by value pieces. You know. There's no data set, for example, of what species is legally traded in what country. You know, what species is, you know, there's a lot of restrictions about captive bred species are okay to trade, but not if they're wild caught. But are there any captive breeding facilities, you know, for a specific species? You know, so all that type of data. There's a great initiative that Oxford is doing right now called Benchmark for Nature, that's trying to improve some of this data environment focused on investors, right? So that that data can on impacts on investment and economic activity and investments, you know, impact on nature, and it's actually science-based. So I think that's a great initiative. There's a lot of stuff actually going on in the kind of sustainable finance field on the data side, which is really interesting. And I would just say, if anybody's out there listening that is looking for a topic for a master's degree or a PhD, you know, developing a useful data set would be, you know, it would be great, you know, so you can do that.
Why not put it out in the universe? The universe will hear. It just strikes me, though, as you were just talking about the difference between captive bred and wild and so on, that's very pre-COVID thinking. Because to a virus, it doesn't matter whether it's captive bred, legal, illegal, sustainable, unsustainable. It's an opportunity. And we have to re-examine all these rules that we've built up over the years with that new public health lens about how to reduce the chance of the next pandemic. It's going to come. It's how to reduce the likelihood of it and how to be better prepared to fight it. So each of you in your own respective spheres and fears, slip of the tongue there, tell me what you've taken from the COVID-19 phenomenon. Who's going to dive in first?
That's a big question. Wear a mask.
The benefits of which are still much discussed in scientific circles. However, go on.
I think the amount of digital transformation, as the term goes, that the world went through because of COVID, everybody hopped online. We learned how to do things like this. We are learning to work together and to create in a new way that I believe is going to filtrate down into the systems we develop for prevention. I can't speak, I'm not a medical person in that way. But I think that, right now we were forced into making a foundation that is actually going to help many things in the future. I can't even say what they are, but I just know that what we have been forced to do through this terrible circumstance, the next time we will be able to iterate faster. But I think in the meantime, we are just going to be able to work better towards solutions in a new way.
Thank you.
Sorry, Ian. Okay. Yes, I was just going to say, kind of living here in Kenya, where we've just watched, as it would be the case, anywhere else, that the tourism has completely and totally died, and the level of reliance that the national parks here, the protected areas here, that the protected areas everywhere else have on that tourism income in order to create the support for the species, for the habitats, even for the communities around, it's just so. It's just so single-threaded against, in terms of that particular income stream. And our need, I think one of the biggest things that struck is our need to diversify the ways that different people can support conservation in different ways has just risen to the top. And we don't know what's going to happen next, but if everything relies on one income stream or two income streams, I think, we're going to continue to be in trouble. So, that's especially being here and just seeing it firsthand and hearing it firsthand. That's probably one of the biggest things that struck me.
Yes. Thank you. It's an important point to make. And indeed echoes our earlier session on innovative finance, because just as conservation for most people is an externality, it's not part of their everyday life, so conservation funding has always been something over there. Or you put your donation into the charity box, or a little bit of your tax money goes to it, but it's got to become internalized into the economy, just as we internalize conservation into our daily lives. I have a note saying that Sarah, there's an 11-year-old who's really keen that you should just say hi. I don't know the 11-year-old's name, but I bet you do.
Hi, Kate. How are you?
Okay. And a comment from Carrie Ashby, who writes, I'm a wellness coach, and I'm using wildlife conservation as a foundation to help my clients progress. By doing this, I'm inspiring a shift in the relationships people have with wildlife. It's the mindset change that Sarah just mentioned. Yogis are conservationists too. And as a part-time yoga practitioner, I couldn't agree more. Does that ring any bells?
Are you talking to me?
Well, I don't know. All of you have to keep, it's one of the hardest things about conservation is to be daily bombarded with all the negative data. And somehow we have to...
Once I opened this, it's almost like a Pandora's box, right? Like once you find out about anything, you start to learn, and especially, this. Project 15 is named after the amount of time that we lose an elephant on this planet. And it was that name, we kept that name on purpose. I mean, I named it and I wanted to change that number till it just was an irrelevant sort of name. At the same time, I've been meeting all these folks that are working on this so hard. And the hope, here comes the hope that you know, it's terrible facts, but if you can just, you'll see all the wonderful work that's being done and being, you know, using a growth mindset where you don't just come in and start learning about it and then figure out how you can help, because everybody can help. And so that for me, you know, hits that it is a very difficult topic. I won't look at any of the terrible pictures, but at the same time, you'll hear, you know, you'll find people like I've met the people that Timothy was talking about that did the Heathrow project. And I was like, oh, I should tell him about, oh, he already knows. Wonderful. Okay. So you learn that it's a small community of people doing amazing stuff. And then you can figure out how you can help, whether you're an 11-year-old watching this show and doing your own thing to what can I do as an 11-year-old and what can I do as an adult to make sure I'm giving the next generation the right tools to get going, whether it's a game for awareness or it's teaching them the skills so they can hit the ground running to make these solutions. It's going to fall on them. So it's a long-winded answer to say it's hopeful within its difficulties when you're learning about it.
Yeah, I mean, I really think in a lot of ways, COVID's the pandemic's creating a lot of challenges, like been discussed. But two things: one, they're creating challenges for wildlife traffickers also. You know, they have to shift. They can't travel. They can't do the same things that you know that they were doing. So in any kind of situation like that, that's a big vulnerability for them. Also, on our side, on the good side, you know, I think in a lot of ways the stars are aligning. I mean, you have, you know, incredibly, you know, powerful partners now, you know, that can really do a lot. Microsoft, you know, the transport industry, the ship, the air bank industry, law enforcement, U.S. Fish and Wildlife is really expanding their international presence. You know, so now there's actually, you know, there's a law enforcement agency that's working, you know, internationally exclusively on transnational wildlife crime. That's never been the case before. I think there's a lot of kind of the dysfunctions of the conservation world, I think are being noticed now and taken more seriously than they ever were before. And I think that's opening up a lot of opportunities. And there's this big democratization, diversification, like Gautam said, of the conservation space. So I think there's a lot of really positive things. I think the challenge is kind of going forward is how well can we sync all of this up for effect, right? And so that's going to be, because if we have a million different great projects going on, which are not coordinating with each other and are not kind of moving things forward strategically, not just tactically, you know, then we end up with the war on drugs, which is tactical success, but you know, you win all the battles but lose the war. And so, but I think we have an opportunity through all these different things, to not repeat that mistake and really end this.
Let's hope so, because there's a lot at stake here, like the future of life on Earth. There are requests here for people to flag up where work can be found. So I don't know if each of you wants to give an easy website. Ade asks, I understand Ethiopia's new airport is very elaborate. You work with the Ethiopian government, Tim, to sort of improve their airport security from a wildlife crime point of view.
Maybe like with many things in Ethiopia, it's complicated.
Yes, well, all of it is. And the thing that struck me from all that you said was the question of cybersecurity. And I had a very rude awakening to that this morning, actually. World Wildlife Day for me was supposed to start with a lecture to an audience in India, and the event was hacked, and propaganda and images that had no place on a presentation were being, and they had to pull the thing. So when you're working with people of the same mindset, it's fantastic to have all this data sharing. But if as you say, someone can bribe you to get the pass that reveals where the rhinos are or which shipment can be flagged through without being checked, then we're just making it easier for the cyber criminal. So I know that's a whole new topic to delve into, and I just invited you to tell people where to find more information about your work. If people are interested in the thing that I was talking about, putting the carbon value attributable to elephants to work in development and conservation, the website is really easy, rebalance.earth. I challenge each of you to have a similarly easy website for people to follow up on what you've been telling us. Sarah, do you want to go first?
Sure. If you want to learn more about Project 15, we have you can go to aka.ms, WAC, Project 15. Maybe AD can put it in the chat.
Thank you. And I'm sure that just searching for Microsoft Project 15 would probably find
it. That'll work too.
I recommend you using Ecosia, the search engine that plants trees. Tim, what's your favorite website for people to look at?
For our work, focusconservation.org, unitedforwildlife.org, also the Royal Foundation's website. Feel free to contact me personally on LinkedIn. It's probably, you know, one of the easiest ways. Welcome more contact.
Especially if someone has ideas that can help with the work. Yeah. And Gautam, I mean, just before we go.
Share information and connect people, so.
Thank you.
Yeah, so if you want to learn more about Internet of Elephants and all the different products we do, it's www.internetofelephants.com. And if you want to play the game that we released just yesterday about the camera trap work, it's unseenempire.com.
Fantastic. Well, that was a wide-ranging and amazing sharing of ideas and to some extent life stories. Thank you all for joining us today. And I hope that people respond and come forward with ideas and just become part of this movement, which is what we're really trying to achieve, a global movement to redevelop our relationship with nature. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you.